this place is special. So Hopevale is an Aboriginal community outside of Cooktown, and it's a 4.5 hour drive from the main city, Cairns, in far north Queensland. And it's very rural. There's no traffic lights. I mean, growing up here, I was always connected to the roots, to the land, to the sea, to the people, in a way that I never felt that anywhere else. And I knew when I was here, I was home. My name is Aisha Waibo. I'm 22 years old, and I'm a Binthiwada woman from Hopevale. So my grandpa's name was Eddie Waibo. I didn't have my father in my life, and so he was that for me. He was my male role model.
This is a perfect example of what my life was like. I used to make my grandma and grandpa race me on the beach.
He finished school when he was 12, so he only got an opportunity to go to school till grade 7. He worked on a station from when he was 13 to probably when he was 17. He was earning money as a stockman, but not a lot. It was next to nothing. Yeah.
I love this photo too.
I felt so much rage as a kid, one, because I loved my grandfather, and two, because I thought, even at that age, I knew that that was wrong. Stolen wages is just, what it's really saying is, Aboriginal people aren't enough.
The stolen wages issue has long been one of the key stumbling blocks in the way of reconciliation in this country.
If you want to understand Indigenous disadvantage, it has its roots back then.
It's estimated hundreds of millions of dollars in today's money was taken and held in trust accounts.
It was effectively slave labour.
What sort of work were you doing?
Well, I started work when I left school, really.
And I was just doing the housework, mopping out, doing the washing up and things like that.
You might say, oh, get on the saddle at 6 o'clock. You'll stay on the saddle nearly all day.
When you do a day job, it's not only one job. Fencing or ring barking, muster, hard work, right? Yeah.
Now I was working for money, but I didn't even see my money.
And I still think of it today, where my money went to.
The stolen wages case has a lot to do with the financial disadvantage that Aboriginal Australians suffer from today, because they have worked their whole lives and not received any pay for it. So the legislation that controlled wages, it really started in 1897 with the Aboriginal Protection and Restriction on the Sale of Opium Act. So it allowed the government to control where Aboriginal people lived, who they were allowed to marry, and what they were doing when they were working. The mission in Hopevale was a Lutheran mission, and that was established in 1886.
So we're now driving up to Old Laura. I had my 19th birthday out here. The old yard is still there. Only the people that worked with me here are all gone. My name is Desmond Charles Bowen. I'm more called the Kogimtan people. So that's the cattle yard and the horse yard. We break our own horses in. I started work with my grandfather at the age of 16. Just waking up 4 o'clock in the morning, coming back to the camp, sometime 10 o'clock at night, you know. And this is where the manager used to stay. At the homestead, well, we sit out on the veranda, and the non-Indigenous people sit inside. They had a little pigeonhole, and they'd pass the food out through that little pigeonhole, you know. You're nothing, sort of, you know.
So the legislation at the time required permits to be entered into with the station workers and the local protector. It required that the wages of that worker be paid direct to the protector and not to the worker.
And I'm thinking, well, I'm busting my guts for this fellow and risking my life. It didn't seem fair, you know. This is a permit for casual employment. under the Act, Aboriginal Regulation of 1945, $21 per week. We're going to the superintendent. And our take home was $3.
The laws were repealed in 1972, so it's actually difficult to establish where that money really went and whether it was properly managed. What happened to people under that control was dehumanising, demeaning, and it has meant that the Aboriginal people in Queensland haven't been able to enter the economic market and be on an equal footing with Australians.
Morning, everyone.
Hi.
Just coming to check on the adopted class, see if they're being good.
Growing up, a lot of the young fellas, they get intimidated. I'm trying to teach them that, you know, just because you're an Indigenous young fella, that you're not dumb, you're not useless. Yeah, I try to reconnect them back into the community and try to teach them that, you know, culture, like something that should be really important in their life and should never be ashamed of expressing that you're an Indigenous young fella, especially from a great community like this. Wandara Yurangai, Natugatil Kitan Bowen, Yingayu Durpilngan, Yi Hope Elwi. Yeah, my grandfather's Ernest Lex Bowen. He's always taught me to work hard and you reap the benefits, but he's 72. You see him every day out there working. I'm sitting in an aircon room with a laptop and computer. I'm trying to make you retire because you're 72 now.
Might be the last year for me.
You said that last year.
Well, if you're working, you're doing something, you know? Yeah. Idleness is the devil's workshop.
In times, he'd go out on a station, a few months on one station, then a few months on the other.
No weekend, nothing. No weekend. No Sundays, Saturdays, nothing. He just keep going, and continuously going and doing work. We don't get paid on the station where we work. I don't know where that all goes. Yes, that's the only thing I've done. I haven't seen him give me money in my hand, you know. No, that didn't happen.
I'd be furious. If he was paid fairly, I reckon, you know, he would have had his own place where he could have lived. And our old people were just living like day to day by pay to pay, you know? It just annoys me that they say that everything's given to us now. Well, no, it's not really.
This offer is made in the spirit of reconciliation, as a demonstration of our genuine desire to heal the past so we can move on.
So the reparations payment that he received when I was 11 years old was around $4,000, and that's when he decided to get a quad bike. And I remember him second guessing whether he should get it or not, and having a conversation with my grandma about, oh, it's a lot of money, do you think it's the right thing I should to do with it? And grandma said, no, this is your money. Go spend it how you want to spend it. And I'd never seen him so excited over a quad bike in my life. Grandpa passed away in 2010, and he died from pancreatic cancer. And all his lessons and all of our conversations, like, they've really shaped they've really shaped who I am as a person. And as much as that my grandfather was a very forgiving man, there's definitely still rage. Let's just call it what it is, rage. And the wages is just an aspect of the fact that Aboriginal people aren't considered of the same value as white Australians. And I think we're constantly trying to prove ourselves and prove that we deserve the same basic human rights that everyone else has in Australia.
So in here is where we keep some of our files on our clients. As you see, there's quite a few and this is only some of them. So we actually thought that we had a small window of opportunity to actually tackle this case while we still had living claimants. We thought there might be a few thousand people, but we didn't want to jump straight into it. So we thought maybe a few hundred. But in the end, we've had 7,000 people register.
Hello.
Hi.
How are you? I wanted to be part of that for myself and for my dad. Well, I wondered what's due to me, you know?
We were setting out to use the class action to try and address a mass wrong of a government. You know, this was money that was privately earned by individual workers, and that came with even more responsibilities on the trustee of that account to administer it properly.
Their numbers may be dwindling, but these Aboriginal and Torres Strait Island elders have not given up the fight.
This has been a long road, and there were some challenges. You know, the state put up a fight.
First, a long-running battle to recover historic wages stolen from Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander workers in Queensland has reached a resolution.
You do have to make concessions in litigation for the risk that you might not win. So this is the best outcome because it's happened now and we can start getting that money out now. This is the largest settlement for Indigenous people outside of Native Title, and that's a huge win for Queensland. That's fantastic.
I don't really think it's fair. Well, that's nearly 50, 40 years gone, you know? And we're supposed to be the backbone of the meat industry, you know. There should be some kind of recognition given to us.
I reckon they still owe us more what we've done.
And you're lucky to get it after all these years.
Yeah, that's right.
And if they could only hurry up, I didn't have a lot.
Yeah, we've got to be quick.
Let us have our money. Be quick about it. I'm not too old now to go out. Go to different home places.
So about 60% of the class are deceased estate claims, and the money will go to the families of those workers. So, and that might go towards some of that intergenerational trauma.
But does it make you angry that you didn't get recognised for like all the hard work you've done though?
No.
So you don't really worry too much about the recognition?
No. To me, money don't change anything. Money, you know, he's there today and he won tomorrow, you know.
I think I want closure, you know. I want their story to be heard and I want them to get recognised for what they've done, because we have a better life now because of those people and all the hard work they've done.
Hey there, my name is Mark Fennell, and if you enjoyed that, and I'm hoping that you did, then make sure you like and subscribe to the Feed's YouTube channel, and definitely watch that thing that I have absolutely seen before. It's really good.